cannot try to moderate them, because they are the architects, one way or the other, of this initiative. And they have been working on this to bring us to where we are over the last 10 years, to the point whereby the African leadership said, okay, we are going to launch negotiations for the continental free trade area. So for me, I would rather ask just a few questions, which I'll then leave each of the panelists to express their views and their thoughts in the context of the backdrop of the mega regional trade arrangements that are happening, trans-Pacific, trans-Atlantic, and also the multilateral trading system, which happens to be a major issue in the next three days. So, these are some of the questions that I hope we can be able to address. How does the CFTA fit in this architecture of the mega-regional trading arrangements? And what should we, as Africa, be aiming for? Are there lessons to learn from the other mega-regional trading arrangements? And how can we ensure that the CFTA serves the development ambitions of our continent? And how can the CFTA influence the position of Africa with respect to the multilateral trading system? And also, how can the multilateral trading system serve the continental ambition as aspired in the continental free trade area? Recognizing at the end of the day, the CFTA is one of the steps towards Africa's regional integration or the continental integration. And so with that, and with those just few introductory remarks, I'm going to give the floor to the UN Undersecretary General and also the Executive Secretary of ECA, who will give us his thoughts and his views about the continental free trade area. I know a number of you may have listened to him about the subject of Africa's transformation. And I would also ask him probably to link this whole trade agenda to the Africa's transformation agenda. Thank you. Sir, you have the floor.
Thank you, Stephen. Very pleased to be here with Erastus Moecha, not only because he's a brother and a friend, and also very important functions he occupies as deputy chairperson of the AUC, but also because he's a trade specialist on his own. So it's very, very good to be with him, and I'm sure we can have a very good discussion. And also very happy to have Evelyn with us. She has been a staunch supporter of better relations between North and South in many functions she has occupied, and now doing a bit of reflection on the same. So it's very pleasant to be with you. Evelyn, Ambassador Nathan also, because I have been one of the founders of CEATINI that is now leading. So I'm very happy to have you as well. As we know, regional trade agreements is nothing new. In fact, over the last 25 years, we have seen a proliferation of the same, from about 50 to about 400 now. So we are quite used to having regional trade agreements of all sorts. What seems to be now catching our eye is what is being termed as mega regional trade agreements. And on these mega, we know that one is a bit more advanced than the others, which is the one on the Trans-Pacific Partnership. But we have also a lot of discussions taking place around the Euro-Atlantic one, and of course there are others that were already very much in the eye of the storm, like the one between ASEAN plus six of its neighbors. Now, what really is interesting is that Africans have also been working on their own mega regional trade agreement, which is the CFTA. But it has been a very slow process, although the official launch of the negotiations started in June this year. And I think the momentum is building, because because there was a tripartite agreement between SADC, COMESA, and EAC that, you know, created more energy around trade negotiations within Africa. And also because there was a lot of controversy in the negotiations between Africa and the economic partnership agreements with Europe. I still think, you know, Africa lost a big opportunity by signing some of the EPAs, and we can revisit that issue. And I'm absolutely convinced it will be revisited one way or another. We are already seeing that ratifications are very low, so everything can be questionable. And there is a new commission in the European Union that may be tempted also to engage in a different type of negotiations, at least we hope. But the question here for this panel is more about, is CFTA being threatened or compromised by all these mega regional trade agreements? At ECA, we did the Economic Commission for Africa. We did a study about that, exactly that point. And let me just go through the main conclusions of that study, because they are very important to inform our discussion. As far as removal of tariffs, tariff barriers is concerned, our study demonstrates that the mega regional trade agreements definitely will be good for those who are members of them, including, of course, the TTIP, the TPP, and the RCEP altogether. By 2020, with the reforms that are envisaged, they can increase trade by $1 trillion. Now, Africa exports, on the other hand, if we do nothing, we just see the sky being occupied and the geography being occupied by this, is going to lose about $2.7 billion, according to our study. It's not a major amount, but just demonstrates that we are not going to benefit from this, and we are going to drag behind, and we are going to lose incredible opportunities. On the other hand, if trade diversion appears to be relatively small for Africa, it should be noted that Africa's exports would fall in all main sectors, especially industry, thereby undermining our, you know, call for structural transformation through industrialization. Also, the loss for Africa may be underestimated, we think, because if you consider more than just the tariffs, probably the loss is much bigger. ECA also considered the situation. If Africa were able to establish its CFTA, and we know that the negotiations just official launch just started, but if we were to do it, Africa's total exports would increase by 38.8 billion, and we can really see from that, you know, the difference.
A sizable amount of this will be intra-Africa trade. And what is interesting is that this intra-Africa trade is going to be mostly on industrial products, chemicals, textile, metal products, as well as electronic machinery and transport equipment, therefore favoring very strongly our drive to industrialize. If reduction of non-tariff barriers through specific improvements in trade facilitation, in line with what actually the World Trade Organization's Trade Facilitation Agreement is proposing, is also taken into account, then these benefits will found for Africa under the CFTA will be in parallel with other mega regional trade agreements. So the message is very clear. Unless we establish the CFTA, we are going to have major problems seeing the rest of the world occupying the space, and us having much more difficulties in industrializing, which is the main driver of structural transformation in Africa. Now, maybe I say two words about why we consider industrialization as the main driver of structural transformation. Because we are linking it with three entry points. that we consider to be within reach for Africa. The first one is commodity-based industrialization, which is about adding value to the commodities that are exported, but we should be realistic about it. We should not look into a complete revolution on value addition, because now the chains of value are much more sophisticated. So if we just increase by about 10-15% what we already have, which is very low, it's about 15%, it's a major creator of jobs. Right now, extractive industries, just to take that portion, because it's the most significant of the commodities, only creates about 1% of formal employment in Africa, so it's very low, but we can create much more. The second entry point is making sure that we do agro-processing. And agro-processing will be the catalyst for agricultural productivity. That's why we focus on industrialization as the entry point, because it has one wing that goes directly into where the most of the labor force still is, which is agriculture, rather than just treating agriculture in isolation. And agro-processing is also the one that can respond the quickest to the expansion of our consumer market. We have about 1 billion people, going to have 2 billion by 2050. The middle class is really in a surge. And in fact, you know, we continue to import about 83% of our processed food, which is absolutely absurd and, you know, can be changed. You know, I was just teasing one of the participants that we even import yogurt. So we are really very, very low in terms of the value addition. And then the third entry point is, of course, taking advantage of the labor market rise, costs rise in Southeast Asia, particularly in China, which will oblige for part of the manufacturing to be dished out of that region, delocalized, as we like to say. And Africa, if the right policy mix is in place, can benefit from this delocalization, at least partially. We are going to have competition, so it's not a given, but I think we have a lot of good megatrends in favor of Africa. So if we take these three entry points, we consider industrialization extremely appealing. And our report that you can take on your way out is basically to make this link between trade and industrialization in Africa and demonstrating how one and the other, you know, can complement if we have the right policy mix. And we believe that you know, our countries have negotiated very badly. And even when they gain something from the negotiations, they implement the agreement very badly, so they lose twice. And there is very little policy consistency, which is responsible for a lot of loss that we now have to try to revert. And then the second last point I want to make on structural transformation relates to the issue of sequencing. If we want to have the right policy mix I was just talking about, it will be very important for us to have a great attention to the issue of sequencing. Sometimes what comes first is going to make or break the possibilities for the continent. Like, for instance, on industrialization, just to take the example of the day, because we just finished the Paris COP21 on climate change. Let's just take that one because it's in the news. Africa, by default, is a low emitter, and therefore it's already in the niche that everybody wants to be. We are there because of poverty, because of poor economic performance, not because of choice or design. But we are there. So can we, that's a question, can we try to maintain that position of advantage, but now doing all the other things that others are trying to do by retrofitting, you know, by basically dealing with mitigation? And I believe we can, because, you know, we have the largest renewable energy potential in the world. We can actually import the huge pollutant type of industries, manufacturing from Asia, into Africa without emitting the same. Because we can empower most of this through renewable energy. we are going to contribute greatly by, you know, having transformation closer to where the natural resources are, so less transportation and emission by shipping halfway the world, you know, the natural resources and then the export markets. And we can also have cleaner technological solutions because we are not married to any technological platform. Of course, this can be theoretical, but if you try to put in place the right policies, it becomes reality. And I can just give you the example of Ethiopia that has a growth and transformation plan that is one of the most ambitious in the world. This year it's going to be a tough year for Ethiopia because of drought, but still, you know, the structural transformation in Ethiopia is based on a very aggressive investment policy. You know, their public expenditure is mostly investment, 60%, which is the largest in the world. And of course, you know, they have decided to go into industrialization, that makes sense, but they have decided to do it in a green path and are actually even one of the most ambitious countries in terms of presenting their plans in Paris with 64% reduction of current emissions, which are very low, by 2030. So, and we can see the first industrial park that they are putting together in Awasa is already an industrial park with the most advanced green technologies or approaches. And of course, they are building their largest dam, Renaissance Dam, which is the largest dam in Africa, and investing in solar, wind, geothermal, etc., to make their complete energy mix dependent on renewables. And what is important is, now going back to my issue of sequence, that if you are going to allow countries like this one, I just gave an example, it's a very striking example, but nevertheless it's just one country, to go in this path, you need to have a certain number of protections. And I am not afraid of using the expression smart protectionism. I insist that, you know, everybody practices smart protectionism. They don't call it that way. They call it something else, but that's what they do. And we should not be shameful in Africa of practicing smart protectionism. And in theoretical terms, it basically means that we don't practice anymore this crude protectionism. It's no longer possible. You know, the world has moved on, has changed. But we can explore the nuances, sophisticated ways of implementing different types of policy and regulatory regimes, and therefore sequencing becomes the most important of all. And just to finish with the economic partnerships agreement with Europe, you know, there's nothing wrong with this expression. Actually, I love it, economic partnership. The problem is that, is it an economic partnership? It can be if it has the right sequencing, but it cannot if it imposes a certain number of rules, a certain number of market access priorities and so on that do not take into account the fact that Africa is not yet industrialized, it is about to in most of the countries, etc., etc. So that's smart protectionism and we have to practice it much more. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So now I'll pass the floor now to the deputy chairperson of the African Union Commission, because like the ES said, he has been in this project of regional integration at the sub-regional level and now at the continental level. And I know he spent a lot of sleepless nights in the lead up to this point where we are. So, Your Excellency Mwencha, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Steve. I'm fortunate to speak after my brother Carlos because he has put the subject in proper context. And so I'll just build on what he has just said. And just to echo what he said, I'm equally blessed to be in the midst of these distinguished panelists, including Evelyn and Ambassador Nathan, who we look forward to sharing their insights as we look at this very important subject. Seeing that we are now meeting in the margins of the WTO, I think it's important just to take the cue from what Executive Secretary Carlos has just told us, to link it to what we are discussing now. And particularly, as Steve asked us to talk of lessons learned, I think it's also important to take some lessons learned, particularly under the WTO negotiations, and how they impact on regional trade agreements, but also the continental, but equally on what we see the way forward. Putting it from the African perspective, Africa has always been very enthusiastic and remains enthusiastic to engage in the multilateral trade system. And in fact, if you look at the WTO membership, Africa is queuing to join and has quite a huge number that is already members. But looking at Africa's engagement in multilateral trade system is very disappointing, because whereas Africa now constitutes 16% of the global population, if one were to go by that equity itself, you would expect Africa to be trading at least 16% of global trade. But Africa's trade is less than 3%. And in fact, what is even alarming is to see that this trade has been declining proportionally. Now, Carlos did mention that when you look at what is happening under these mega trade agreements, they are going to dominate the skies. So when you look to the future, it is even worrying. Now, how do we as Africa then see WTO? We saw WTO from two important perspectives. First, as a rule-based, and two, as one that would be able then to engage in differentiated but equal responsibilities, where you would recognize that all the players are not in the same league. Those of you who watch football, you know that, you know, if I know many people watch leagues all over the world, Spanish, English, you have leagues. And those leagues, you know, you have the Premier and lower division, where you allow teams to practice and then come to the Super League. Now, this is where the crux of the matter is. Because WTO, being an arrangement that should be able to recognize that, has not then lived to that. Because going back to the Doha, initiation of the Doha, and for one who was fortunate to participate in the Seattle, the reason why Seattle failed is because Africa was demanding that the new trade round to be negotiated had to have a development component. And because Africa's voice was not being heard, the meeting more or less collapsed amid the start of protests. But of course, at that time, those of you who remember, in the US, they were also looking at as WTO as being very invasive. And so you were all protesting, but for various reasons. But at the end, that incoherence led to that kind of collapse of Seattle. Then, of course, you remember, and this will come out later on, when you go to Cancun, the crux of the matter was then, what do we put on the agenda in terms of the key areas like agriculture and the rest, where others were saying, well, don't put on this one because for us, our electorates are very important. We cannot touch agriculture because it's so sensitive to economies. But Africa's voice was not being heard. Now, the Doha had a very important component that has over time been lost. Going back to the league, the reason you allow this league is then to have a development component, which was to be incorporated in the Doha round. And the development component was simply then to say, How do we ask support the LDCs and other direct economies in the same league to also come to the Super League? And that's why there was a development component. But as you know, the negotiations have steered very much away, the only harvest being what was done in Bali, where you had trade facilitation. But again, if you look at trade facilitation critically, you'll conclude that for these countries in the LDCs, trade facilitation is not a key, really, achievement, because somebody will say, trade in what? Yes, and when I come to the CFTA, I'll be pointing out that, yes, trade facilitation is key to Africa's being integrated in the global economy, but also for its own good. But at the moment, you would say, perhaps the major beneficiaries of the Bali are at the developed countries, because if you make access to the market easier through trade facilitation, it is those that dominate the skies that will benefit from that. So where did we then end up with this, what Carlos has said, in a mess like EPS and the rest? You know, it is because of MFN. Everybody then said, the reality of global trade system is here, and everything must be coherent. If you are not compatible to WTO, you will be in a way in breach of the WTO. And since we are members, we were then told, okay, you have now to negotiate a regional trade agreement in order for you to be compatible and coherent with the global trade systems. And so that's how Africa signed up to economic partnership agreements. But then, and this is, I think, very important to bear in mind, and many of us argued from day one that if economic partnerships had to be compatible with the WTO, we needed to wait for the outcome of the WTO negotiations so that then EPS would be compatible with what we already know. But that was not to be the case. In fact, it was pushed through, and as we have just been told, we now saw a reduction of ambitions, eventually coming up with agreements which are now finding it very difficult for ratifications, because many have realized that what they signed up to is, in a way, for lack of a better word, a death sentence. Now, here we are. We here in Nairobi, and the discussion, the key discussions appear to be two. One, for 15 years, you are not making substantial progress. And yet, the key elements of the development, and bearing in mind that in Africa, you have 34 LDCs out of 49. So Africa, as such agenda, has not been addressed under TDA. Do you abandon it? The answer is that will be treacherous. But then what do you do? For 15 years, we are not achieving progress. And there are really substantive issues which remain. Do you continue because the rules under which you are negotiating don't seem to be producing results? But of course, we saw what happened in Bali. You were able to derogate one of the rules, a single undertaking, you were able to achieve that. How do you then now move forward, perhaps with new rules, so that you can make progress in some of the key areas that Carlos has mentioned, like industry, agriculture, and the rest? I think this is what we should now zero in. Now, Africa being persuaded to join this IPAS or AGOA. By the way, AGOA is different in the sense that it's unilateral. And we have been telling our friends that part of that, many of us would believe that, okay, if you are in a regional trade agreement, one of the reasons, the benefit of regional trade agreement is that it's stable because it's legally binding and therefore it's predictable. The problem with the instruments like AGOA is not. And that's what we were persuaded to join the Economic Partnership Agreement because Africa was then in danger of losing its exports, particularly to Europe, which at that time was a major trading partner. But as we now speak, Europe is slipping from being position number one of as a trading partner. And in fact, when you look at the nature of Africa's exports to Europe, if this is what you are going to sustain, it's going to slip further. And in fact, you can see now China has overtaken Europe. And tomorrow, you don't know, India could overtake and the others. So Africa is in this now crossroads. But I don't think it's a crossroad that says we cannot look to the global trading system. Yes, we need to engage the global trading system, but that global system must recognize that Africa has an agenda that must be addressed. That agenda includes industrialization. And of course, poverty, reduction of poverty elimination, which means you retouch the very core of Africa's development agenda, which is agriculture. And so we need WTO, because without that discipline, it will not be difficult for us, for instance, to bring agriculture under the discipline if it is not under the WTO. But then, where does Africa go from here now? Of course, we cannot go to the octarchy that we close Africa's borders and start industrialization. As I said at the beginning, it's a reality that we now are in a globalized system. We are interconnected. We are interdependent. But that interdependence must be under rules based that recognize our differential system. And that is one of the basic principles of the WTO, recognizing the differentiation amongst ourselves, but which we are not living to. Now let me then turn to talk about the CFTA. The CFTA will make sense if Africa can then sequence, and I think this point was well articulated, sequence by us recognizing that we de-emphasize Africa's looking to EPAs, AGOAs, keep them as a spare, but not that's the wheel that you drive on. And so Africa should now look internally, because there is a huge potential for Africa. Africa is young, has a population of 1.1 billion, and you have seen that China has been growing basically because of this, but also resource rich. But beyond that, its capacity to consume is also rising. And so there is a market, but that market does not exist at the moment. It is in 54, which means to consolidate this market should be priority number one. After that, then you can be able to move to the next stage, which involves us to do industrialization. So in terms of sequencing, the continental free trade area is extremely important. And as one who has come from a regional trade agreement, I can tell you that if you look at even what has happened in terms of the shocks that we now have in the nature that Africa is exporting primary products, they were less in the countries with regional trade agreements, because if you look at what happens within those regional trade agreements, there is more of industrial goods in it, which makes it less volatile than when you are dependent on primary goods. So to me, priority number one for Africa is then to engage in the continental free trade area. And the rest of the world should understand this. When Africa engages in the continental free trade area, it doesn't mean that they are going to lose. In fact, you end up in a win-win situation, because Africa's industrialization will engage more with the rest of the world. Because where is technology? Where is manufacturing? So it shouldn't be an alarmist statement when we talk of Africa going into continental free trade area. That is actually should be good news. But at the moment, if we continue to embark on EPAs on all this, Africa will remain fragmented, weak, and so it's a lose-lose situation.
So I think this is what everybody should support. Then, of course, if you look at some of the sectors that Africa should continue to engage, it's agriculture. And we know that this is one area where Africa has comparative advantage. But distortions globally make it very difficult for Africa to feed itself, leave alone Africa being the basket of the world. And that's why the Nairobi outcome should be important for us to achieve our three result that we say we must, from what has been a major issue from Cancun, that the rest of the world takes it seriously to remove, for us to play by the rules and remove trade distorting subsidies that make it difficult for us to work in a field that is, at least then when you are in that league, you know that you are playing by the same rules. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mencha. So now I'll give the floor to Her Excellency Evelyn Hopkins. You've been working a lot on these development issues, looking even at the North-South development issues. So please give us your thoughts on the CFTA in the context of the mega region.
Yes. Let me start out with saying that over the last decade, I made many, many speeches about the need of for Sub-Saharan Africa to integrate in the world economy. But all these speeches for the last 20 years focused on what rich countries should be doing. I've been attacking EPAs, and I've campaigned for many years now that the OECD countries should harmonize their preference schemes for Africa. And over the last few years, I've been campaigning that TTIP, TTIP would give the opportunity to do so between Europe and the US, and I'll come back to that later. But this is an occasion, the first in many, many years, that I can also say maybe a few things that Africans could be doing, should be doing a bit better themselves. We know the continent is incredibly dependent on exports to destinations outside of Africa. Other regions, other continents, trade with each other way more than Africa does. And we also know that global value chains basically virtually surpassed the continent. So Africa is very vulnerable, and we saw with the slowdown in the demand for commodities in China, what that meant, it immediately translated in slower economic growth also on this continent. So trade integration is essential to implement Africa's vision for economic transformation. And it's high time to take away the impediments for intra-African trade. And we're not just talking about trade policy here. There is as much, this is about lack of infrastructure, because still today, very sad, transport links to the outside world are still better than the links among each other here in Africa. So it's time to work on that, and a lot of homework has to be done, and I'm very happy the African Development Bank is really doing a great job in creating and improving regional transport corridors. But also intra-regional trade suffers from cumbersome border impediments. And so actually, I disagree slightly with His Excellency, Mr. Mwenja, that I think that the Bali Trade Facilitation Agreement is actually a good thing for Africa. Now, I find it as annoying as you do that the United States and the European Union have put enormous pressure on Africa to ratify this, and of course that's to the benefit of their exporters, but I firmly believe that it is in Africans' own interest to adopt simplified and harmonized custom procedures to facilitate imports, if only to accelerate integration in the region itself and to enable participation in global value chains. Now, on trade policy proper, Africans made a lot of efforts, in a way maybe too much efforts. There are too many preferential agreements with multiple and overlapping membership. And if you add to these agreements the preferential schemes like AGOA, EBA, EPAs, etc., I can't imagine, you must be an incredible brave and persistent entrepreneur to navigate this myriad of different rules and procedures and export anything to anyone. Now, also, Africa suffers from a lot of agreements in name only, political declarations which are not really implemented. I sometimes wonder to what extent these lofty declarations actually resonate in capitals. There are way too few countries in Africa that seriously integrate trade policy into their national policies, into their development, national development plans. But I do hope that the times are changing, and I think the recent breakthrough on the tripartite free trade area is very important. Of course, again, if it is implemented and if rules of origin and other rules and regulation would indeed be simple and transparent. But then TFT could be a fantastic stepping stone for the continental free trade area. Again, assuming that CTFA is more than just a political declaration, which it better be, because I think Africans should have a tremendous sense of urgency about this, to get this done really soon. Now, as a European, I've been living through the creation of the European Common Market, and let me give one lesson learned there. The importance to marshal public support, including among your private sector, within Africa, public support for regional integration in the spirit and the vision of Pan-Africanism. Political will can only be sustained if political leaders feel that they don't lose votes by pursuing a vision, an idea. Now, creating a common market is easier said than done, and it will take time, but again, I don't think the continent has time to lose, given the external environment and particularly the threat posed by these mega regionals. Obviously, TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, will divert trade. It will erode preferences, and in fact, particularly, will hurt sub-Saharan Africa. Tariffs between the United States and Europe are already very low, but some goods still have tariffs in double digits, and these are exactly on processed agriculture products, footwear, textiles, and clothing. And exactly these are the sectors in which developing countries have a comparative advantage. So the TTIP potentially hurts Kenya's export of flowers, Ethiopia's vegetables, Lesotho's textiles, and Ghana's and Mozambique's fisheries. Now, there are too few studies on the impact of TTIP on sub-Saharan Africa, but they do quantify the damage as at around 1% of GDP. That doesn't sound that much. But the problem is that all these studies are about averages. And that means that behind these averages, it's perfectly possible that for some poor countries, some sectors, the losses could be devastating. And an even bigger problem to me with these studies is that they ignore that TTIP will not only impact on present exports. It might nip in the bud future exports potential before it's even unlocked. And this is happening exactly at a time that African governments are improving their governance and are creating the conditions for investment in, for instance, processing agricultural commodities and light manufacturing. So TTIP threatens to snatch your markets away from them before you even had a chance. For instance, Cote d'Ivoire, Ghana, to enhance its market access, market share, and value added in cocoa products. And while there is a lot of debate on the potential negatives of TTIP, both in Europe and the United States, there is very little debate on these continents on its impact on low-income countries. But I can give you a sliver of hope. The Dutch Minister for Trade and Development has sent a letter to her parliament last month stating that at least the Netherlands commits itself to prevent that TTIP would be at the expense of low-income countries. Now, how will they do that? Let me elaborate the four points that she mentions. First is to use TTIP to harmonize the preference schemes of the United States and the European Union to improve their utilization. And I'm actually delighted about this suggestion because I've been campaigning for this for many years now. Indeed, presently, both the EU and the US have their preferential schemes, benefiting some poor countries and or some products in sub-Saharan Africa. But the sum total of these schemes is a hodgepodge of multiple and different conditions and rules, hardly generous, hardly helpful, and quite a nightmare for African exporters as they cover different countries, different products, and have different rules of origins. So harmonizing these schemes would be very helpful, And I'm glad the Dutch government is focusing on that. But I think that only would be helpful if we best features of both programs, which means on country coverage, FOA basically governs most of Sub-Saharan Africa, while the relevant European everything but arms is only for this 20-some least developed countries. So that's the country coverage. Product coverage, the American scheme is pretty stingy. So I think we should agree in terms of product coverage to indeed what the Europeans call everything but arms. The second suggestion of the Dutch government is to make rules of origin for TTIP not unnecessarily strict. What that exactly means, I don't know, but we need radical action here because indeed rules of origin are a daunting obstacle. They raise cost, and not just for the exporters, also huge administrative cost. They require enormous documentation, and they create huge burdens on custom authorities that already have limited institutional capacity, as you know. Worse, the Americans and the Europeans have a different mythology to define origin. So poor producers have to adapt their manufacturing processes in order to comply with substantial different conditions that they impose, sometimes incompatible with each other. So I do commend the Dutch effort to make these rules more flexible and not unnecessarily strict, but I'm not sure if that is meaningful enough to improve improve utilization. So what I would campaign for is both flexibility and mutual recognition of each other's rules of origin. By accepting that an import is eligible in one market if it is in the other. Now, the third suggestion of the Dutch deals with the issue of standards. Indeed, TTIP initially aimed to harmonize standards, which would then imply that also third countries only had to deal with one set of standards. But during the negotiations in TTIP, it turned out that that was way too complicated. So a lot of stuff is going to be mutual recognition, which would imply that still exporters from third countries face two different standards. So the Dutch government suggests to extend that benefit of recognition, mutual recognition, to low-income countries, and I think that's a very good point, and I hope it's going to work. Finally, last point, the Dutch government wants to include in TTIP, where it is, they have a chapter regarding trade and sustainable development, the obligation to monitor the impact of TTIP on low-income countries. I think that's perfectly fine, but that might be too late. So I think this is really the time for Africans to raise their voice to be heard, to tell the US and the EU to deal with the negative impacts of TTIP ex ante as a precursor to the overall TTIP agreement, instead of just being one of these issues that they will deal with somewhere a decade down the line. Plus, in the meantime, I would suggest Africans that all the negotiating already overburdened trade capacity you have, negotiating capacity, to urgently focus that on deeper integration within the African market. That's where you should focus on your trade capacity. And in the meantime, you should actually demand a standstill on trade negotiations, any trade negotiations with third parties that require reciprocity. And that would include particularly EPAs, a standstill in order for you to be able to work on your common market, particularly EPAs, because they are very disruptive to your own integration efforts as all these groups overlap. And all of them include EBAs, LECs, or who already have EBA. I actually find it scandalous that EPAs require reciprocity, given the state of development in most sub-Saharan African countries that is totally inappropriate, even with long transition periods. And it set a very bad example. The fact that the Europeans have been requiring reciprocity in EPAs actually has inspired the United States recently to also consider to introduce reciprocity in AGOA, in their scheme. Great harmonization, yes, but in the wrong direction, to the detriment of Africa. So I think this is really time for Africa to raise its voice, to demand action to prevent negative impact from TTIP, and to demand breathing space to focus on your own integration. Now, while you're asking that, I would advise you to remind the Europeans and the Americans of the most important feature of the Marshall Plan was that the United States actually allowed Europe to give priority to regional integration and cooperation among ourselves, while in the meantime allowing full asymmetric market access for us Europeans to the American markets. I think that's a great example of solidarity, which today should be applied to the African continent. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So we pass the floor now to Ambassador Nathan Irumba. You started these negotiations for the WTO and the EPAs, so you have the floor to hear your thoughts on the Continental Free Trade Area.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. Taking the floor after these prominent people have been talking. Taking the floor after the prominent eminent people have talked, it's difficult to know what to add on. I worked with the Ambassador Africans in Geneva when she helped us as LODCs to prepare the integrated program within the WTO. Of course, the Executive Secretary helped in founding Siatini, and Dr. Mwencha worked with him when he was Executive Secretary of COMESA. When I look at what is going on now, it reminds me that it's important always to put your home in order. This is when everybody else will respect you. We look at the Chinese. Sometime back, people were laughing at them, but they said we shall deal with the world when we are ready. So they exercised their policy space, were able to develop at their own pace, and began opening up as systematically when they could ever compete. Now the problem with Africa, we have tended to move from one ism to the other ism, and we have followed at times Big Bang liberalization, which in many cases we have seen our industries disappear. Now, for a long time when I was a young man, Uganda used to export textiles to East and Central Africa. In fact, used to export underwears to Harrods. But because of this sequencing of liberalization, those industries which were in place were decimated, and we're now net importers of many of these products we used to produce. Now, at the international level, whether the multilateral level which I've been involved in, lopsided liberalization, even within WTO. And in fact, what we are seeing now of the impasse is exactly that those do not power works. So there has been what we call don't want to open up in those areas where they don't have a competitive advantage and are aggressively pushing for opening up the economic space, whether it be within the carbon area or within the case of trade area. So we have to, first of all, that's why I think the continental free trade area becomes very important. In the discussions, I always tell my friends in Kenya, a long time ago, and I think now we are, that we seem to be so much of our old Europe. At times we forget that actually our biggest trading partners are our neighbors. Uganda for a long time was actually the biggest trading partner of Kenya, surpassing Europe. But so in our mindset, we tend to consider Europe as the most important thing. I'm not saying it's not important, but when you look at the anatomy of the exports to the Europe or to Europe, it is we are locked up in the exports of primary commodities, and which really will not help you so much if you're talking of transformation. So regional integration is the way to go. And I'm glad that the focus on regional integration is important. And we have identified a number of clusters, trade policy, trade facilitation, productive capacity, trade-related infrastructure, trade finance, trade information, and factor market integration. Currently, there is this narrative of global value chains. I think wherever you read the Dunkard reports, WTO reports, the emphasis is saying how you must integrate in value chains, otherwise you'll be left behind, or alternatively, liberalize so that you can participate in the value chains. But the critical issue is how you are involved in these value chains. Evidence seems to show that much of the value chains actually, the benefits remain with those who have technology. That smile card, what the economist told the smile card, so those who do the designing and take the value and the marketing, whereas we are the lower part of the smile. So we have to be careful on how we get integrated into these value chains. And to me, the smart integration would begin at the regional level, because that's how we'll be able to build up capability to be able to. I tell my colleagues in Uganda that you are unlikely to export cycles or pangas to Europe, but you might export them to our neighbors. So this is the testing ground. The real area where you will experiment and evolve will be in global value, will be first for encourage local and regional value chains which promote integration. Now, how everybody now is excited about the megas. I agree they're important. But I have done some reading of them. If you find that the aim is to actually to establish higher regulation, higher standards, and hopefully materialism at the next level. That's why you find the US is saying, well, and it has been always happening whenever they are stuck in WTO, they say, we shall go with the willing partners. But usually you'll find out in the willing partners, they'll still demanding high intellectual property protection, high investment liberalization and protection, and no agriculture. So we, as we try to negotiate or to understand what are the bigger, let's study them, I agree, but the most critical thing, let's understand how will they impact on our regional integration. And that's how they think about the ECA and AU are important here. To be able to harmonize the evolution of the RECs. The danger is the RECs will want now to negotiate individually with the megas, as it has happened with the Economic Partnership Agreement. But that could hamper, if they're not systematically coordinated, it could hamper the emergence of the contentious free trade area and a common market. So that's why I would look at the ECA and the AU playing a key role in trying to harmonize our relationship with the external world. We have made a mistake so far in the Economic Partnership Agreement, and I agree with the Professor Efkin, so to say that for a long time, the EU was guided by their global Europe strategy, which is no export. And I tell my Ugandan colleagues and East African colleagues, do we have an East African global strategy so that we can engage with the EU? Or do we have an African global strategy which informs our discussions? For them, they're clear. We have to open markets for investments, investment protection. And if you look at all these mega regionals and even bilateral, it is the same policy. They are very clear on what they want. We have a rendezvous clause in the South African Partnership Agreement with the EU, which commits us to negotiating intellectual property rights, commits us to negotiating further liberalization of services, competition policy. Now, I have no problem with a country adopting its competition policy, which suits to its own characteristic. But if the competition policy, which suits only the other industries, that might not be the best for us. And I think that's where we need to coordinate our activities, I mean our policies in Africa, to make sure that these don't run counter to the objective of continental integration. Now turning to the, of course we are now in the margins of WTO MC9. I was there since Singapore, and at least I've had the privilege of attending the all the ministerial meetings. But what has always struck me as odd, that when you have clear on what you want and you are stuck on it, then you get, there is a, in diplomacy, if you can't convince them, confuse them. So instead of addressing the question really of special and differential treatment, as we had agreed, we are being diverted on what is a developing country. I remember when I was, you know, saying, let us agree first on what we shall give developing countries. Then we can determine who will benefit. And I'm sure some of those countries whom are the people threatened, whom are saying that, oh, we cannot deconsent this, S and D and T of these countries, would be willing to discuss, even for them to be able to make a provision. To contribute. But now this has become a total diversionary issue. I was reading Froman's article in the Financial Times, where he said the world has moved on. But as it has moved, agriculture still is there. Why do you continue if it has moved on? Why don't you liberalize agriculture so that we might be able to benefit? So I always argue people to try to look at the big picture. Don't be diverted to what I call diversionary tactics. Now, for Africa, we must be very clear. And I was at a meeting of the Commonwealth recently here in Nairobi. And I said, yes, the mega regionals are there. They have decided to put their house on order. But the critical idea is that for us to strengthen ourselves, why is anybody negotiating with China now? Because they have strengthened themselves. From South Africa, we can strengthen ourselves by utilizing our resources, upgrading, developing technology. And the danger of these regional by other bilateral agreements, particularly there is a craze for now investment agreements. And in our quest for FDI, everybody being persuaded to negotiate an investment agreement. We have carried out a study. If you look at the templates which were being given to negotiate, these are the templates, as I think somebody said, they say, don't do as we did, do as we say, because they will deny us the ability to require an investment to be productive or to direct an investment to go into areas where you want. So, yeah, those are my few remarks. And I'm glad that I'll be able to participate. Thank you.
Thanks, Ambassador. I'm actually calling my colleague to see whether we have the 15 minutes that we lost because of the previous group, so that we can take some questions. Oh, great. So we have about 15 minutes. So let me thank the panelists for their thoughts. Now the floor is open for engagement. And please also feel free to raise questions on the basis of the presentation of His Excellency Erastus Mwencha. The panelists will try to take some of the questions. So the floor is open. Yes, please. So we'll start with Kenya Human Rights Commission. At least I know which organization. Then we'll come to the lady in the middle here, followed by the gentleman behind you, and the other gentleman to my left. So we take those first.
Thank you very much, Chair. My name is Frederick from Kenya Human Rights Commission. My question goes to our panelists. Anyone could answer, and thank you very much for your presentation. What has been agreed at the mega regionals? My question would be, is it legal for you to multilateralize them, multilateralize whatever you have agreed? Because they have used the GATT rules to come up with those agreements in terms of the standards and also other areas of agreement. Is it legal for you to take it to the WTO and make it a legally binding agreement? And the question would also focus on how exclusive they have been, because most of the countries are not part of the mega regionals. Secondly, is on the CFTA and the levels of liberalization. If you look at the EPA, for instance, 82% for the East African community goods are to be liberalized, 75% under ECOWAS. What would be the proposal moving forward for these blocks to focus on, and especially to cap their level of opening up their markets? Thank you.
Okay. My name is Margaret Colley, and I have a background in extractive industries, and I'm also UN Habitat Advisor for Africa. First, I'd like to agree with Carlos' comments that on the three steps for structural transformation. Nevertheless, it would be important to add energy infrastructure and interconnectivity in terms of not only land, sea, air, but also digitally, which also connects very well with what His Excellency Erastus Mwencha mentioned on focusing on a market internally. Though my question goes on to ask on what you alluded to based on the UNFCCC conference, what opportunities are there for Africa to industrialize while retrofitting and, you know, mitigating the effects of climate change?
Thank you very much for this interesting session. And thank you for that that introduction almost, Margaret, because I'm going to talk about or ask a question about services, really. I'm not entirely sure. I missed the first 10 minutes, my fault. So I'm not entirely sure, but I think in the time that followed, I didn't hear the word services. And I'm missing it badly, because if properly looked at, I think we're looking at north of 50% of trade in Africa already today. It's just not counted as services, because it's either not counted at all, or it's embodied in some goods, or embedded in some goods, or otherwise related to some goods. So we're not seeing it. That's, for me, a disaster, because when we're talking about intra-regional trade, in goods, sometimes question of compatibility or not compatibility of the economies, but in services, trade is a lot more obvious between equal and similar economies. That ties in with my follow-up question, which is, of course, the question that is on display here. What's the impact of the mega regionals, the other mega regionals, on Africa's trade? And here I would invite us to think of whether or not there are win-wins coming from regulatory integration in those other intra-regionals, and not least thinking perhaps heretically about TISA as something that could actually be a train to be jumped on, or at least sort of hung on to for Africa. I'm saying all of this because I've worked on Africa's services in the least likely corners, which is least developed country services exports. And when you actually get out of the office, dump all the papers and talk to service providers, you will find very surprising things, like Ethiopian software shops that built M-Pesa systems in Nigeria, things like this, much hampered by very clumsy visa procedures, much hampered by all kinds of licensing oddities that can usually be dumped because they're not serving anyone. They're just still there because we are not paying attention. And I think this is where trade could really make a lot of difference. I'm almost tempted to say, you know, forget tariffs for the moment. Just focus on regulation. And by that, I mean SPS, TBT, and services, in addition to TF, trade facilitation, which we all talk about all the time. And I think we will see great gains, low-hanging fruits, and usually a lot less political resistance. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I am Mr. Mamadou Sall. I am from the Islamic Center for Development of Trade, the NOIC organ, of Islamic Conference based in Casablanca. Yes, regarding the CFTA, it is a very good thing for Africa, but I think if you look at the statistics of intra-African trade, it seems like 12%. More than 85% is going for outside Africa to trade. And in Africa, we have ECOWAS, we have CEMAC, we have WAIMO, we have AMO, we have Tripartite, we have COMESA. When we go to CFTA, what is the future of this regional agreements? It is an important thing to do. That overlapping of some in some countries, they have some bilateral agreements. It is the second question is what is the role of private sector in this CFTA? As we know, the private sector is the key engine to apply laws and some trade agreements in Africa. The third is regarding the roots of origin. As said by Mr. Zevelin, it is important in Africa to harmonize as roots of origin and go to E certificate of origin. It is one of most important things in Africa, in the world in general. And also the second, what is the technical assistance of EEC, of ECA in applying the TFA? It's important in the category C to have technical assistance from donors. Thank you very much.
We'll take this first, and if we have more time, we'll take another round. So, starting with Mr. Lopez.
Thank you. I think these were great questions. I'm going to be very brief because of time constraints. But let me tell you that, you know, when it comes to, and I wanted to also comment a bit on two points that Evelyn made to defend a bit my brother Moencha about trade facilitation. In fact, what he meant, Evelyn, and this is part of the discussion we have been having, is that we are not against trade facilitation because, in fact, it's fantastic to promote intra-Africa trade. It's, again, the issue of sequencing, whether we are being imposed a set of rules and a set of standards that we cannot be ready for immediately and therefore incur revenue loss because of that pressure, or whether we should promote trade facilitation because it is needed for intra-Africa trade first, and then, you know, give us a bit more time to get to the standards that will also. So it's in that sense, I think it makes sense. The other issue is on the mega regional trade agreements. You are absolutely right on the issues regarding, you know, the Dutch proposals and other like-minded measures that will help make that agreement better for Africa and for low-income countries. But what we have been challenging is the fact that all these mega regional trade agreements, not just that one, are going to impose a set of standards, rules, regulations without our participation. So even if it is, you know, some like-minded people wanting to make it less harmful, the problem is that we are not at the table, and unless we also create our policy space, internationally speaking, we are going to just at the end of the day, the best we can hope for is something similar to AGOA, which is unilateral. You know, we are giving you A, B, and C, but not that we have something that we have negotiated between the two parts. But I think you will agree with all of those. I'm just making them clearer. On the issue of energy and infrastructure, of course, when we say there is these three tracks of possible industrialization drive for Africa, I have not spoken about the means that will allow industrialization to take place in the first in the first place. And of course, infrastructure is absolutely key, energy in particular. And of course, the reason for this discussion is that trade is also key. And there are a number of other ingredients that we'll have to take into account to make our broth. And I think we have seen a surge on investments in the area of energy in particular, in the continent. We still have a big deficit of investments in this area. About half of the requirements are being met with new investments, so it's still a long way to go. But it's quite promising because it has been quite a change in relation to the past. Now, let me tell you something that I think permeates all the questions that were raised here or comments, which is we are seeing more and more, and Ambassador Nathan also mentioned it indirectly, we are seeing more and more that these definitions of G77, developing countries, etc., they have a political content and they have a political meaning, but in negotiations, they shortchange Africa a bit. Unless Africans put their case very articulated in a very sophisticated way before the rest of the G77, developing countries, and so on. When we do that, actually, because of not only the numbers, 54 members, but also because of the special attention that Africa deserves, when we articulate the positions before the rest, they are taken into account. And therefore, Africa expands its voice. But when Africa does not do that, it suffers from, you know, being just used by numbers without having really a contribution that is meaningful. And this is particularly true in the trade area, and then now it's permeating many other negotiations. Let's say climate change is another example. But do we have the same interests on trade as China? Because it's G77 in China. Do we? No. I mean, we are in a very different category. And in fact, we need to negotiate with China almost the same way we negotiate with the European Union, the US, and so on. So to be together in some of these negotiations has become a bit, obsolete in the way we articulate African positions. And there is no other area where this is more evident than trade. So from trade, we can derive in a number of other areas. Let's say some are very soft, like sustainable development goals. It's very soft. But in fact, do we have the same interests in negotiating this global agenda as some of these big emerging economies? The jury's out. But I would challenge that Africa really has an interest in just following. So unless we have our own articulated position and position Africa to lead, at least in some areas, it may suffer just by being, you know, a residual player. And this is true for some of the issues that have been raised. And let me just comment one more on the services. I do think that, of course, services is extremely important. And if it was not explicitly mentioned, it's because it's partly because the dynamics of the negotiation also are pushing services a bit further away. And we have been focusing more on the immediate consequences of some of the determinations that are being made now. But it is absolutely essential for the future. It's just that Africa is the only region in the world that has moved from low agricultural productivity right into services, boom, missing the middle, which is the manufacturing industrial transformation. And that's why we have so much emphasis on it. And also because our service boom has been influenced by a lot of informality, you know, very low fiscal pressure, a lot of activities that are in precarious survival type, and of course a lot of polarization because the most value addition is coming from very small area of services like telecoms and banking and financial services, and not, you know, expanding the value to the full range of services. So we have those issues that are internal to us, and that may justify why, you know, psychologically we didn't cover services as much in the presentations, but I don't think it's because of neglect or not recognizing its importance. And finally, my last point is about intra-Africa trade. I think it is very important for us to start really questioning this not 12 but 16% intra-Africa trade, because this 16% intra-Africa trade has three qualifications that are required each time we mention the figure. The first qualification is that that's the African average, and that African average is strongly influenced by the poor performance of North Africa, that is the least integrated with 3%. The second qualification that is very important to make is that this is the official trade figures. And as we know, customs in Africa are customs in Africa. I don't need to say more. And then third, it's very important to know that our regulators and our capacity, statistically speaking and otherwise, is not equipped for the type of cross-national transactions that are taking place in the service area in the most sophisticated value addition sectors, like, for instance, telecoms with roaming services or financial transactions with Pan-African banks. So all of this justifies that number. That is a gross underestimation, but it is the number. It is the official.
Thank you very much. So, the issues that were not touched on by the Executive Secretary, quickly from Evelyn, followed by Ambassador Iruba.
Well, I quickly wanted to tell Carlos that I agree with him that including trade facilitation, that African countries need to have space to breathe and, you know, sequence. But as far as I know, the Bali Trade Facilitation Agreement does give room for that. So, you know, you could still ratify it. Secondly, I do agree with Carlos that what the Dutch are doing with trying to prevent negative impact of TTIP on low-income countries is a band-aid on a real bad thing. And tomorrow I'll make a speech in the NGO Center explaining how bad these mega-regional are, how they discriminate, and how they replace the WTO, suck out the oxygen of the negotiation there. How wrong it is for us to set standards and then tell the rest of the world, take it or leave it, and then the others have no choice. I totally agree with everything on that. But does that mean, as a question came, are mega regionals illegal? Now, even if there were, the problem is we live in a world of sovereign states and nobody can send the police to someone else if they break rules. But it's even questionable if they actually break rules. When I was a WTO ambassador 20 years ago, there was this committee in the WTO that was looking into these free trade agreements. But given the fact that nowadays there's not one member of the WTO that is not itself involved in free trade agreements, the degree of policing each other is not very serious there. So in short, yeah, I'm afraid it's bad, but legal. I mean, whatever legal is. Let me finally say that I totally agree with the points made on the need for within Africa simplified the rules of origin for each other. That was a very important point. And I also very much agree with the point made on services.
Ambassador Iruba.
Thank you for the questions. Now, trade facilitation, it's supposed to have been a friendly agreement. But when we were negotiating the mandate, we had asked, and that's how you find that, the implementation should be contingent on the capacity of the country to implement that. And that's how it differs from all the other agreements and the provisions of technical assistance. But the problem which has been in terms of implementation is the pressures which have been put on a number of countries to declare that they are ready, when actually they're not ready. It becomes a beauty contest that I am ready. And the customs people, officials at times have engaged them. They want to say, we are ready, but I said, have you tested it? Are you ready for now, or can you continue to sustain that capacity? They are blank. So, yes, trade facilitation agreement was supposed to have been very friendly, but I think countries should be left to use that discretion to declare when they are ready or when they actually are ready to implement those aspects. Services, I agree. Now, the question again which came up was a question of the private sector. Now, when you talk about the private sector in Africa, the private sector is weak. And the problem has been over the last year that the role of the state has been whittled down. Now, in Uganda, I may always make fun that we privatized, but we allowed South African private companies, state companies, to come and take over the running for supplying electricity, which means that if what we need is a developmental state and to develop the capacity of the state to be able to implement, to carry out industrial policy. Now, unfortunately, for some time, it is now, even the World Bank has begun to realize that actually the state needs to be again developed to be able to engage in carrying out developmental policies. And I was reading at least the Economic Commission of Africa has been trying to see how it can help the state carry out this role. So I think we need to rethink again the role of the state. Services is important, but in the services, embedded in services, investment. And that's why you must be very careful about the rules. Will these rules allow you to be able to develop your own local service providers and give them capacity to grow and practice? I'm not saying you go back to what we was called the rigid state, but I think the role of state is very critical, and we need to strengthen it and remove all the impediments which prevent a state from carrying out that role. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, why we had this session is so that as you interact with the delegations whom you are going to be doing for the rest 3 days, please, you've heard the voices, you've heard the messages. We hope those messages are going to filter through so that as our negotiators take their positions and advance the discussions, at least they are informed by what you have heard. And one last point, please note that one theme from this panel was that regional integration is actually a priority for the continent. And I would like to tell you that the Economic Commission for Africa is actually taking a lead with the African Development Bank and the AU Commission to work on an index, the Regional Integration Index. And through that index, we are actually looking at all these dimensions, some of which you had mentioned by the panel. And we are hoping to launch that during our Conference of Ministers in March. And hopefully, we'll give you a tool that can help you hold everyone into account, whoever makes the decisions and whoever is expected to implement those decisions and whoever is supposed to generate the knowledge to move forward the agenda. So thank you very much for your time. Let's give a hand to the panelists. Thank you very much.